Yeah, so what is this CIFC? I is just on the agenda, so talking about it. It means a continuous integration, it means that so basically every developer works on the master branch directly, and it's not just in the case that the patches are prepared in a separate branch and then we push to the master branch as a big package, but rather try to have it as continuously as possible. So if some part of the features where it gets submitted and it doesn't take half a year to pick this dropped, and this should make it easier to not step on the other type of stores to refactor in the same area of the code. So if you wait until a month or two passed before submitting your changes, the risk of having a merge conflict is better to solve. So by integrating early, we try to remove this. And this is also, of course, not really true. We also have patches prepared in separate release branches, and also we, of course, pass our patches and prepare it. So it's not a really direct pass workflow from the developer's machine to get it. And also, the developers don't constantly update their working branches to avoid. So also what CI refers to is actually the tooling, the system that is used to automatically compile the code and check some things, and in some cases also do automated package. And yeah, of course, why is it a good thing? The good thing is because it tests platforms that the developer might not have access to. Typically, or most of the developers are working on Linux, a couple of Windows, and Mac. So our infrastructure builds on all those platforms, and typically also the machines we have on our infrastructure are much faster than the ones that developers at home, except for the main build environment. And also has the advantage of being a uniform build infrastructure. So the developer has an old compiler, and the build works for him. That doesn't mean it also works for the different person that has a newer version of the compiler that introduces a new warning that is treated as an error and makes them really fail. So having a standard system that all developers can agree on, I'm sure that at least it's a known good state where the patch gets integrated and everything else are just side effects. Because if you want to check out the master and update your code, you don't want to have a quick break and to do some compiling on what or just because some other person checking something that may not work anymore. Yeah, and what we do use in the LibreOffice project is twofold. I mentioned we are using Garrett as a patch and review system. This is where the patches are submitted to for code review by a human, but also by for review by the Jenkins CI. There's a web interface that is typically used by viewers to set their commands and commands, but advanced users can also use a command line interface to do it all for the terminal. And it's basically where the results are executed to by Jenkins. Jenkins is the system that basically pulls the queries directly for what changes are available, what needs to be checked. And then has a scheduling system that distributes the builds, the patches to the different build nodes. And then after the build request has the results, submits it as a vote to Garrett. There's a plus or minus one vote on the verified kernel Jenkins, and for patch to be integrated in our branches, we require that it has a verified vote and a plus two on the code. In addition to the Jenkins, we also have tinderboxes, and those don't build individual patches, but rather build from the branch after everything has been integrated into the branch. And this can catch issues that are not seen by patches in isolation, but might be because they have problems that only appear in the combination of patches. And those Tinder boxes are also the machine that provide the daily online templates for creating people to download and to test. So, and what are the drawbacks or limitations you have with such a system? This basically points all down to how long do you need to wait until you have your results back. And LibreOffice is a large project, and it of course takes a long time to build, and some platforms are faster than others. For example, on Linux you can use Zcash to accelerate your build, and in Windows you don't have a factory, all you have is a pre-compiled optimization. So we are basically bound by the speed of our Windows builds. Windows builds take typically 50 minutes if it's a single build, or 80 if two builds are run in parallel. And for the Linux GCC one, a build is finished in less than 20 minutes. And of course, also for Mac, we don't have such a uniform hardware landscape. So we have a slow mix in our list of build platforms that take up to 3 or 4 hours to go full build if there are lots of changes in the learning modules and not many hits coming from the C cache. But this is only one part of the equation. Of course, the hardware is limited despite having quite a reasonable amount of build costs. For example, we have 4 dedicated machines by PDF for Windows and one additional server sponsored by Bytemark that is also doing some things, and specifically the Bytesec repositories. We have a bunch of Macs, of which 3 of them are Mac Pros, Trashcan Sky ones, and the other ones are Mac Minis. And of course, we have a couple of Linux machines, but not all of them are doing Jenkins certification builds, but only with dedicated tasks like, for example, crash test ones or also LCAF coverage reporting and similar stuff. So we have, of course, the problem. You cannot just buy tens of thousands of machines and have an idle just to be able to accommodate a load spike. It is also caused by having people mostly in one time zone, most of them. So there's the bits are not evenly distributed throughout the day. So the spike in the European working hours and during European night is going to be key than anything. But the biggest problem we have are the random failures that are not directly correlated to the patch that was tested, but of course the problem is in the flakiness of the test itself and the flakiness of the Windows system typically. The test just fail and spoil the results. The poor developer submitted the patch, did nothing wrong, but still the Jenkins said, no, I don't approve your patch, I give a -1 mark, you cannot integrate it. And then, of course, Stefan's talk also about touch quality. It's hard to find out what exactly went wrong in the test phase because the reporting time for the test is sometimes subordinate. Yeah, this is basically what we have. So, what has been done to improve the situation? First, we tried this to introduce touchstone builds, as they are called in Jenkins. And the touchstone build is basically a build that is done before all the others. So only if the touchstone build passes, it tries to build the other platforms. And this then, of course, is an artificial delay. We build the Linux one first, and only if the Linux one passes, because they are so fast, then we can move to the slow systems that might take much longer to get the code break value. Of course, this didn't work out so well because Linux ones is the ones that is used by developers, and developers typically also compile the code, so they don't submit something that is known to break. So typically, we don't see that many breaks on Linux, but rather on Windows or Mac, because these are the platforms they don't have access to typically. So it helped to improve the situation where we had really large build queues, but in the end it was abandoned because it didn't really work for us. Then of course we tackled a simple thing. We had a time off of it when it was stuck in a test, for example. But initially, when we did first set up Jenkins, it was an absolute timeout. So we had to save it for the slowest build machine. So the timeout was more than 4 hours, but not 8 for the slow, it makes it 3 hours for a regular build. And of course, even if the 20-minute builder on Linux gets stuck, it still needs to wait for the 3 hour time to begin before being killed and making room for another build. But this now has been changed to basically to a guess whether the build is stuck by looking at the build output. So if there's no build output anymore for 14 days, then the build is good and it should allow for slow tests that don't produce output if they're running without the shield, but still catch the builds without wasting too much time. And this was a simple thing that kept from an impact, but of course, only has an impact if something is wrong for it, so it's only helps in the worst case. What we had to switch from the Matrix project that was used before to a multi-drop Matrix project is basically a way to trigger builds in Jenkins. And we are really making use of a configuration like this. It is more meant for things like we have an operating system, we have 10 versions of the Python installed, or 10 versions of the compiler, and want to take all of them, or a couple of them. But we at the Ubergrowth project only test for Linux, and there is GCC and Clang, and Mac and Windows. So we didn't really make much use of it, of this configuration system, and it had its own limitations in the study. For example, this is the view you get for the result in the Matrix project. In this case, of course, you would just be happy because you will see all green dots, and there's nothing to worry about. But if you were to have a failure bit and wanted to see the log, you would have to use first the link to the configuration name, and then you have the configuration symbols, the mobile page, and from there you can open the log. So the multi-job project looks like this. So you have more detailed information right at the front. You see the build time as well, and also have a direct link to open the log. In this case, it's also a green build, so nothing to worry about. And the multi-job has the biggest feature in Huawei, or at least I was adding it, is the ability to resume ability. And resume means that to only rebuild the ones that did fail. So you see here there's also a trigger option. And this is also a Matrix project. This one to just requeue the whole change that is a whole to be rebuilt on all platforms, even if they previously already did one success. In some cases, we have a patch to take Windows, and we would use resume, and it would only rebuild the Windows build. This, of course, helps to keep the other Jenkins build slaves free for doing the other bits that are in the queue. And this is a change that I'd like to improve the situation. But of course, needs someone to actually look at the results and see what can be together, since this is not an automatic standard. And of course, I mentioned that the builds are not, the build machines are not equally fast, so another thing that I introduced was a priority. So the faster build machines have a higher priority, and I prefer to there either compared to the ones that are taking 2 or 3 hours for a build. This is especially helpful for Mac, because there the difference between a fast and a slow process is the most apparent. For Windows, it has to be different because almost every bit takes 15 minutes, and for Linux, once it's not fast enough, but for Mac, this really made a difference. Also, I added a fast track priority for release branches, and because this is a more critical, for me, it's a release engineer, obviously, because I don't have the patches for the release branches, so those are taken into account for building stuff from master branch. And this also helped a little bit to basically play better with something hardware you have available. Another thing I added was a build failure analyzer. This is basically a system that both through the build log and reps for normally the failure states and that presents it along with the build results. And this has regular expressions in which you can add your own failure case management as it's called in the Jenkins UI. And yeah, it helps to see at a glance if your workflow or your patch and Jenkins says, no, the patch is not okay. It now also sends the reason why it's not okay, not just a build failure. For example, here you see, I think you can read it, it's a compiler error. So it's a use of undefined type in some file, and then the developer typically knows already all the information. So this the file can be created, just print off the patch and not bother about actually going to Jenkins and open the log and go through it tomorrow itself. And with this, basically made it possible to add automatic retries, since now we know why we type failed. For example, when the failure causes the bot just lost the connection to Jenkins and didn't send any update anymore. For this case, we can just start the bot automatically and not bother the developer with the bot to Jenkins and hitting the scene button for breaking the patch. And right now, this is used for the case when the bot loses connection. This is for all systems, for Linux, Mac, and Windows. And the other two cases that are specific to Windows, we have cases where maybe just crashed out with the standard out error, can't open standard out anymore. And it's basically hard or even possible to debug just this happens, you just restart the build and retry. Also, similar with the related to another JavaScript project is the MSPP server. Windows can get killed with another build phase that is run concurrently. And this is, of course, also nothing that is related to the code, just the cache program. This is basically the killed mercilessly and the build phase. And this is a problem you can handle automatically. For example, if you look then at this in the results, you see the two error symbols. This means this build can fail with one of the known issues and it was triggered automatically with no by the developer. And also look into how we can make more use of our hardware by some monitoring to it, and it turned out that on the Windows screens we have quite much of a large phase at the end, the start of the build, where lots of threads we have in those machines are basically idling to just the single core tasks, and also done quite a proportion of the middle of it. So we added the option to have the two builds simultaneously. And this was one of our problems because Jenkins by default uses the XML in the past and path, and this was not able to fail. But thanks to the triple Bergman, this one was fixed in our build system in the office code, and we can now just use the default without the messing around with the Jenkins configuration. And this is used on Windows for the all builds, and on Linux only for the two different kinds. So there's this GCC and a client build that can run simultaneously, but not two GCC builds or two client builds, because I wanted to limit the amount of disk space required just to load the cache and C cache, but it's better when the password or the path knowledge stays the same. Also, because of our random processes getting stuck sometimes on Windows, Jenkins sometimes had to actually team up properly. There were a lot of processes that then made a subsequent build fail. So we added a single handler to our builds work wrapper that just kills nine of the processes in the process group that are still left after we disabled it. And while this works for most cases, it can also backfire in the case where it's just using some git operation and leaves a git log file behind, because this was all subsequent bits available by failing to check out, because it can't run from the git repository because it thinks git is is still running because it's the log file. And of course, there's also some logging food, like, for example, changing the default view of Jenkins or default view. Basically, to list all the tools we had, or the stages of all the tools we had, and this different partners, but it's not because the new multi-jump ones we didn't delete all the bits. So, the partners of doing this is just really slow and just changing the default view to not show the overall stages around the garage interface go much faster. So, for people who are actually maintaining for work or triggering drops and also. For those who are making difference. And this is basically where we stand now. What still can be done in the future improvements is to better handle the what I call something fast and throttle. For example, if a bot fails in the first 2 minutes, then it's free again for the next minute, and typically the next minute also gets in the business of the same issue. So it, both in 20 or so bits that are waiting and just face them, and it wouldn't take a human to reschedule the bits just because the bot went hammer and didn't break all the bits. So in this case, we need to have an automated system that recognizes that there's something wrong with the bot itself and just take it offline so no bits are assigned to the spot anymore, so the queue that is waiting for to waiting. The process doesn't get corrupted basically by the end and just getting all of them on the same machine. And it's a little unclear how to handle it because typically the failures are unknown and there's no clear indication on what to look for in the log or in the output. So still is thinking about how to handle it properly, but if you have some suggestions, just drop it down. Also, we have a problem that the developer has worked on a lot of patches locally and submitted it as a package to get it. This, of course, makes them all be queued up and blocks the queue for other things. And if one of those patches then has an issue, the bit breaks, then it's also very likely that all further bits that have this one commit as the parent will also break. But right now there is no system to detect that this is a part of a series of patches that have one that fails, it's a known failure, so it would still try to build those in a way, and this basically is a waste of resources and blocks the queue for other developers. So this is something I would like to look into and then either assign the patch tiers and all priorities or others just get a queued further up in the waiting line, or just stop processing the remaining series altogether until the patch is fixed and not correctly built. And while it's possible, we have the build failure analyzer to show the results and the build result. There's no way Jenkins can actually search for one of the failures. So if you want to ask Jenkins for asking all the builds where there's a companion issue, then you can't do it. In the build history, there's just a pop sign, an iPop sign. When you go over to shows the failure result, and there's a command is included, but this is uncomfortable to use. And the only workaround for this command is to search for Jenkins, for the Jenkins command. Garrett, for back to Jenkins to remember. Especially, why is this a helpful or I want to have it is to find out when was the error shown up the first time. So right now, it's more on the guesswork because the build number itself doesn't tell when a picture part of the code is most capable. So you can submit a patch now. Your code is based on a master branch of 2 months ago, then you'll have a fresh build number but then a code base. So this makes it hard for a problem showed up the first time. Having a search feature, some statistics, some additional statistics, and then Jenkins will make this a little easier. And of course, since it wasn't really expected that Jenkins would be used for you. Soon builds it the first time, it wasn't in the list of services to hook up to our single sign on. But of course, now it makes more sense to have all committers on the people for commit access to be also to Zoom build, not only having people in the list of Jenkins and sign on triple matches, and they can do it. And that it's been automatic, and with the commit access, you would get the permission to receive builds. And of course, there are some UI tools also necessary, or at least not in everything, but this is a wishless item. There's a UI port in the trial system that it shows a big event to try the resume entry in the main portion of the page, but it does not hyperlink it, so it doesn't do anything. If you actually want to resume the link, you have to go to the site and do something there, so this is some confusion. So I did catch up quite a bit, but not enough, so yeah.